Good morning. Good to see everyone here this morning. If you have unspoken prayer requests you'd like to signify with upraised hand, let's remember the need that was brought during Sunday school for my dad's brother, Uncle Robbie, I understand, is in critical condition or needs the Lord's help. So let's stand and we'll look to the Lord in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the great privilege of gathering together in the house of worship this morning. We're thankful for the good instruction in Sunday school that we've already received. What an important part of our lives and of the Sunday services, and we appreciate this opportunity. Father, we pray for our uncle, father, or dad's brother, who seems like is in a critical condition. We ask you to move in there and help in every way. Father, be in this service this morning. We need you in a great way. Be with each one that's gathered in. Our desire is to help people, and we know that's your desire too. We ask you to help us all. We need you. We ask you to remember our nation too in a special way. Go with us in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's remain standing. We'll sing together.
Let's turn to page 469 in the Church of God hymnal. Page 469.
Amen.
Thank you.
Let's sing page 217. Page 217.
Beautiful. Thank the Lord. Beautiful song.
My brother. Jesus died and rose again so that you could know the joy of sins forgiven.
The blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, and cleanse your deepest sin.
Try to cover deep within, and everybody thinks your life is in control.
You can run, but you can't hide. God sees everything inside,
but forgiveness waits at the foot of Calvary's cross.
Before I met Jesus, my life was empty and vain. And nothing ahead could I see but sorrow and pain. But then at an altar one night I knelt, and I found assurance that never has left. And Jesus was right for what was wrong in my life.
Jesus is right for whatever's wrong in your life. Jesus is right for whatever's wrong in your life.
Jesus will prove that everyone is sinful. comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word. Just open your Bible and read till God's voice you've heard. Then at an altar in repentance kneel, and you'll find assurance that you'll know is real. For Jesus is right for whatever's wrong in your life.
Jesus is right for whatever's wrong in your life. Jesus is right for whatever's wrong in your life.
To the Lord when I was just a little girl, 8 years old, 71 years ago. And we think of this song as sort of trying to convince the sinner man that Jesus is right for whatever's wrong in your life, and that is true. But when you come to Jesus, I thought as they were singing, Jesus has been right for anything that was wrong in my life. And I'm not talking about sin, but we come up against many challenges in life. Jesus has been right for every challenge in life. We're not capable of handling our own situations. It's not in man that walketh to direct his own steps. That includes all of us. None of you, no one is smart enough to choose their own path. And you have many obstacles, 71 years of obstacles from time to time. But you know what we always did was drop to our knees and seek God's direction, God's solution to the problem at hand. And I say that for the benefit of, these are a beautiful group of youth who are choosing to serve the Lord. And I'm so thankful for them. And I want to encourage them as you walk along through life. Jesus will be right for whatever happens in your life. He's there to direct you, to lift you up, to solve your situation. I highly recommend him, and I'm very thankful that I can testify to the fact he's never failed me. He's been there. He's not failing me now. He's here in this situation in my life. God is here. I feel him. I see him, and I stand amazed at how he can work in our lives if we allow him to. And I'm just thankful this morning.
sun broke through and a brand new day came dawning in my heart. And I thank you, Lord, for what you mean to me.
Once I carried is gone forevermore. My steps that once were feeble are bound for heaven's shore. I'll keep on climbing upward till I receive my crown. But until that happy, happy day, I just won't turn around.
I won't turn back no more.
28 in the evening light. Page 28 in the evening light.
I just want to thank God that I'm here. I want to thank God for his salvation. And this week I was at a parking lot, and it really bothered me how this lady was dressed. And I'm thinking it was just it just bothered me so much. And I just thank God that he pulled me out of a life of sin, because Jesus showed me, Trina, that's where you were. That's where you were years ago. You wore things like that. And I just want to thank God that God brought me to a place where there's truth that's preached and there's holiness that's preached, and that we are taught modesty that covers our whole bodies. I mean, modest to the apparel that God wants us to be. And I thank God for that. And I just thank God that he brought me to the Church of the Living God.
A loser without direction, I drifted aimlessly on the backside of a place called nowhere, forgotten by humanity. When they talked about potential, they did not refer to me, 'cause everyone could clearly see what I was, I'd always be. But he saw not what I was, he saw what I could be. When he his hand to where I was, he made a change in me. For all he had to hope for was just a possibility. But still he saw not what I was, he saw what I could. So now you know the reason I lift my voice so willingly. If he had not found me when he did, I'd still be lost as lost could be. And now I'm so thankful for the change he's made in me. From the life I lived just yesterday, before the Lord found me. But he saw not what I was, he saw what I could be. When he reached his hand to where I was, he made a change in me. For all he had to hope for was just a possibility. Still he saw not what I was, he saw what I could be.
Amen.
And now you know the reason I lift my voice so willingly. If he had not found me when he did, I'd still be lost as lost could be. And now I'm so thankful for the change he's made in me. From the life I lived just yesterday, before the Lord found me. But he saw not what I was, he saw what I could be. When he reached his hand to where I was, he made a change in me. For all he had to hope for was just a possibility. But still he saw not what I was, he saw what I could be. For all he had to hope for was just a possibility. And still he saw not what I was. Still he saw not what I was. Still he saw not what I was. He saw.
And there's no way I could express to you how he was with us and how he helped us. First of all, I want to say, you know, the song, he says, still he saw not what I was, he saw what I could be. And I just want to thank the Lord for his mercy and his kindness, and I'm so undeserving of that. And, you know, we weren't sure how we were going to get home from Alabama, because after I broke my leg, my leg healed up really well, thank the Lord, but I just wasn't as strong as I was before, which wasn't all that great anyway. But, you know, we thought, well, we'll drive to Texas and we'll get Neil, and he can either, you know, drive the van all the way home by himself as fast as he can, and I'll fly home with Richard, or you know what. We didn't know what to do. We didn't know what to do. And then my dear sweet cousin passed away, so it was like as fast as we could, we wanted to get to California and be with her sister, her only living, you know, relative, and who had come from Mexico, and help out as much as we could. And God saw us through over all those miles and through many difficult situations. And I can't thank him enough. You know, when we left, it was the end of October. And in those short period of months, there were 6 people that we knew who passed away. And of course, our dear brother David, and we were so sorry not to be able to be here for the funeral. But 6 people, it was really hard. And, you know, it just reminds you that life is short and life is full of change. And we don't know how long we're going to be here, but it's our God who doesn't change. Through all the seasons of life and all the changes that we go through, it's our God who doesn't change. He's with us and he helps us. But he wants us to be that light and that inspiration and that help to all those around us. And I just want to endeavor to do that in a greater way. And I am so happy to be home. There's a big part of my heart that's in Alabama, especially because of our little granddaughter. And you know, wherever the saints are across the land, that's home in a sense, right? But Camby will always hold a very exceptional, special place in my life. And I'm just thankful to the Lord for all his goodness, for everything he's done for me and my precious companion who takes care of me 24/7 now. I'm just thankful for God's goodness. And
no matter how weak I am or unable to do things that I used to be able to do, he still has the work for me to do. So I just appreciate your prayers that I can keep finding that work and endeavoring to live up to it. I just thank the Lord for his goodness today.
I want to thank the Lord for his traveling mercies. And, you know, we got to be in Sylacauga and see the funeral. But before the funeral, you know, we went to, you know, three different congregations, and I got to testify on how Brother David affected my life.
Man.
You know, and, you know, when I first came to the Church of God, you know, that song that the choir or the quartet just sang, you know, I was nothing. I sat there. I had a hat on. I didn't know, you know, like, are you supposed to take these off? You know, I mean, I had no clue about things, you know, and Brother David showed me so much, and he gave me so much love, you know, and the song, I Saw the Light, that I first sang, he encouraged me to sing that, and it was a Hank Williams song, and Hank Williams, I don't know if you know, he's from Alabama, and they do, in Montgomery, they have a grave, and the grave site, they got a big stone thing, and it says, I Saw the Light. Now, before he started singing, he sang a lot of gospel. And then he got famous. Then he started singing worldly songs. And then he went to the Grand Ole Opry and sang all these songs. This song I'm going to sing is a Hank Williams song. And I think Brother David would have encouraged me to sing this. I found it when I was back in Alabama. It's called Are You Walking? And by the way, our little grandbaby, Lily, she's just walking around now. Pretty soon she'll be talking. And that's what this is. Are you walking or are you talking? Okay, bear with me because it's been since Alabama since I played this. On your journey to the grave, would you stop and try to save? Are you walking and talking with the Lord? Would you lend a helping hand to some poor sinner man? Are you walking and talking with the Lord? Are you walking? Are you walking? Are you talking? Are you talking? Are you walking and talking with the Lord? Are you traveling in his light every day and every night? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? If your heart said testify, would the world hear your reply? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? Would you stand and shout his name or bow down your head in shame? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? Are you walking? Are you talking? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? Are you traveling in his light every day and every night? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? When the time has come to go, would your road be white as snow? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? Will he take you by the hand and lead you to the promised land? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? Are you walking? Are you talking? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? Are you traveling in his light every day and every night? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? Are you walking and a-talking with the Lord? Yeah. Amen.
Good job. Shall we stand? We'll look to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness. So good to have the Cranstons home, and it's good to see the Myers here this morning and all of your precious people. We ask you to help us now. As looking at the pages of your eternal word, give to us that which we stand in need of. Remember this great nation. Remember our Uncle Robbie in a special way at this point in his life. Go with us now in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Let's remember our special service tonight. Ordinance services. Try to be here if you can at 6 o'clock. Matthew, the 27th chapter, beginning verse number 1. Matthew 27. Please take your Bibles and study with us this morning. The Lord, I believe, directed me in this direction last night or yesterday. Matthew 27 and verse number 1. When the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? See thou to that. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. And the chief priests took the silver pieces and said, it is not lawful for it to put them into the treasury, because it is the price of blood. And they took counsel and bought with them the potter's field to bury strangers in. Wherefore, that field called the field of blood unto this day. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremy the prophet, saying, and they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of him that was valued, whom they of the children of Israel did value, and gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord appointed me. Verse 3, I want to draw our attention to this morning. The Bible says, then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself. Or one rendering, a couple renderings say, regretted what had happened. Another rendering says, regretted what he had done. And brought again the 30 pieces of silver, the Bible says, to the chief priests and elders. This morning I'd like to speak on the subject of regret. Regret. Judas, after he betrayed him, the Bible says he repented himself or regretted what he had done. He regretted what he had done. A sad and sobering reflection of a life lived out in sin is all of the if onlys and the what might have been. The choices and decisions often made on a whim, no thought of God's word while wandering far from him. If counsel was received and instruction been observed, their destiny would be different. Soul saved and preserved. But now their days are over. An unpleasant fate they've met because they failed to listen. Now forever faced with regret. Regret. I want you to listen to me this morning. These thoughts came to me yesterday, and I believe this is a very serious subject for us to consider. Regret. Don't raise your hand, but have you ever regretted something you said? Something you did? Or perhaps a decision you made? You spoke without giving it much thought. You moved too quickly. And you made a decision hastily, only to live to regret it. Perhaps it is something in your past life that you did that still haunts you to this day. Regret. Thinking this morning in my own life about some just situations, some maybe a little more light-heartedly or light-hearted, I should say, in my life that I kind of regretted. I was thinking about when I worked at Progress, a landscape company. In our trucks, we had two solo backpacks. One was contained an element or a chemical called Roundup that we would use on the beds, and that would basically kill everything. And then we used a product, I believe, called Confront that we used on lawns, and that would kill all the basically broadleaf weeds, but wouldn't kill your nice green lawn. Well, those solo backpacks, or those backpacks, looked very similar. Basically identical. They were marked. I think maybe one had a green lid or something, but basically very similar. Well, there was times when we would do 15, 16, 17, 20 some lawns a day, and you just get in a hurry. Well, on this one beautiful home and lawn, I grabbed the wrong backpack and went to spraying in the lawn with Roundup. Well, I lived to regret that decision in the weeks to come as I was left overseeding and reseeding that beautiful lawn here with these big brown spots in the lawn. We make mistakes, don't we? And we have regrets. I was thinking about another situation when I was working at Randy's one time, and I had Pryor in the truck, and he was pretty young. He may be the little Dalton's age back here, or Urban's age, or somewhere in there, but he was in my truck just kind of hanging out while I was hurriedly working around Randy's property. And I would check on him. Randy had some windows in the back of his garage. I believe I could see all the way through the garage to the front there to my truck. Well, I was working away, and I'd check on Pryor and work away and check on Pryor. Well, I worked away and checked on Pryor, and he was across the street in the truck. And somehow had gotten that vehicle out of gear and gone down Randy's long driveway out into busy Northeast 52nd, which can be a very busy sort of side street there, and somehow ended up in the neighbor's driveway across that street, the base of the neighbor's driveway. But things happen. Some things can be very serious and very life-changing. Regrets. Do you have any regrets in your life that maybe haunt you and you think about? Few of the followers of the renowned British naturalist and father of evolutionary theory, Charles Darwin, realized how he later felt about the results of his own speculations. Lady Hope, a British evangelist living around that time, or a little after, but during his time, she tells of calling upon Darwin and finding him reading the book of Hebrews. Now, what's in the book of Hebrews? The famous faith chapter, chapter number 11, right? Darwin described the book of Hebrews as a royal book. Lady Hope spoke of creation and of the treatment that Genesis account of it had received on the hands of some. Darwin fairly wrung his hands as a look of agony came over his face. He said, "I was a young man with uninformed ideas. I threw out queries, suggestions, wondering all the time about everything. The ideas took like wildfire. People made a religion of them. Oh, if I could only undo it." End quote. Exclamation point, end quote. Charles Darwin. A few weeks later, he went to his reward. It's been said of all sad words of tongue or pen, the saddest are these: "It might have been." To avoid facing this sad and sobering commentary of a life lived out in sin filled with regret, we must learn from these examples. Like the one in our scripture text, they've been penned and preserved for our benefit this morning and today. And we must learn from the examples like Judas and purpose in our heart that we're going to do differently. Here in our scripture text, we find one of Christ's own disciples regretting a decision he made. Let me read it to you again. Matthew 27:3. Then Judas, which had betrayed him when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, "I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood." And they said, "What is that to us? See thou to that." Jesus' formal accuser wanted to drop his charges, but the religious leaders refused to halt the trial. Judas changed his mind, but it was too late. Many of the plans we set into motion cannot be reversed. It is the best to think of the potential consequences before we launch into an action we may later regret. This is why we need to sit under the preached word of God and get to church so we can hear these warnings, lest we're faced with regrets. Judas, which had betrayed him when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself, or he regretted, and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders. In the Greek, this word repented, or repented himself, this expression, in the Greek, it means to regret, be filled, or he was filled with remorse. It actually means, listen to me now, to care afterwards. But how about if we care before? We're not talking about repentance here. This is a worldly sorrow that Judas exhibited. Repented himself. The Greek word is not that commonly used for repentance as involving a change of mind and heart, but rather regret, a simple change of feeling. Regret. The coins which had once gazed on and clutched at eagerly, Judas had, were now hateful in his sight. That individual you're seeking, that job, that promotion, that move you're desiring, if it's not in God's plans for you, you better let it go. You better drop it. Judas held tightly those 30 pieces of silver until he experienced this regret. Then it meant nothing to him. We better be sure that God's in our plans. God's, listen to me now. I've been around the church all my life. I've never left it. I've always been right here. Always been right here. God gets blamed for a lot of things. Well, God told me to do that. Are you sure? You know how we know? Because it'll be backed up by the Word of God. And your pastor will know too, by the way. God's given him a little bit of understanding. He'll know too. We better be sure, because God gets blamed for a lot. And if we're not careful, we're going to live to regret the decisions we're making. There is something terribly suggestive in the fact that here were no tears as there had been in Peter's repentance. Peter, the Bible says, wept bitterly. We don't read that of Judas. We don't read that of Judas. What we find here is not godly sorrow, but worldly sorrow. Listen to the words of the great apostle in 2 Corinthians 7 and 10. Paul writes, 2 Corinthians 7 and 10, "For godly sorrow worketh repentance." When one's really sorry for their sin, they repent. And that repentance is a change of mind, a change of heart, a change of direction. You do different. But that's not what we see with Judas. He goes on to say there, "For God's work worketh repentance unto salvation," or it leads to salvation, "not to be repented of, but the sorrow of the world worketh death." Did worldly sorrow work at death in Judas's life? Absolutely. Spiritual and eternal, or physical and eternal. It led to eternal separation from God. Let me read this in the Amplified, 2 Corinthians 7 and 10. "For godly sorrow, that is, in accord with the will of God, produces repentance without regret." Isn't that good? You're not sorry you got saved. It's without regret, leading to salvation. But worldly sorrow, the hopeless sorrow of those who do not believe, produces death. Judas was sorry for the result of his actions and sorry for how things had turned out, but not sorry enough to make a change in his own life. Godly sorrow goes much deeper than the sorrow of this world. Regret is being sorrowful, mournful, or to be sorry for a past mistake or decision. A person can feel regret over past mistakes, decisions, life events. It is not uncommon for many people to regret a specific time period in their life or a certain mistake they made in the past. Now this morning, I want to look at three ways we can avoid regret. Three ways we can avoid regret. I'm interested in avoiding regret, aren't you? Interested in avoiding regret. The first way to avoid regret is to receive counsel. In the multitude of counselors, there's safety. Receive counsel. We can avoid a life of regrets if we will receive or accept godly counsel. Every one of us must be willing to hear, listen to, and lean into godly counsel and spiritual instruction. Every one of us must learn to listen and lean into godly guidance. Not run from it. Not turn away from it. Proverbs 19 and 20. Let's take the words of the wise man here now. God's eternal word, Proverbs 19 and 20. Hear counsel and receive, here it is, receive instruction that thou mayest be wise in thy latter end. In other words, in time to come, you'll be wise. You won't have regrets. Why? Because you've received counsel. You've received instruction. One rendering says, listen to advice and accept discipline, and at the end you will be counted among the wise. Isn't that good? Listen to advice, accept discipline, and at the end you will be counted among the wise. Judas Iscariot was one of the 12 original disciples who lived with and followed Jesus for 3.5 years. He witnessed Jesus' ministry, his teaching, and his many miracles. He was the treasurer for the disciples there. And just 6 days before the Passover, we read where he used his trusted position to steal from their resources. Just think about all this. Do you know what? Money was important to Judas. How many live to regret their choices because money has too much a hold on their life? And they lay out of service. They lay off of their spiritual exercising, reading, praying, because money has too much a hold on them. Popularity, prestige. Money was important to Judas. He was a thief. And according to Matthew, the 26th chapter, the chief priest paid him 30 silver coins to betray the Lord. At the Last Supper, Jesus predicted his betrayal and identified the betrayer. He said in John, the 13th chapter, verse 26, Jesus said, "He it is to whom I shall give a sop when I have dipped it." And when he had dipped the sop, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. Judas had not received and been obedient to the counsel received from Christ. Jesus warned him, and he warned him again, but he didn't receive it. In fact, Judas was empowered to do what he did by the devil himself. Look at John, the 6th chapter. John, the 6th chapter. Amen. There's times when we preach messages to really encourage, like we did on Wednesday night, and then there's other messages that God sends to warn us. And this is a warning message. John, the 6th chapter. John, the 6th chapter, verse number 70 says, Jesus answered them. This is after the defection of many disciples. Many turned away and walked away from Christ. Jesus turns to the 12, and we read in verse 68, then Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life." Well, Jesus came on down there, and the Bible does, and Jesus addressed Judas. He said in verse 70, "Hast not I chosen you 12? Haven't I chosen you 12? And one of you is a devil." Now, Judas wasn't the devil, but he was allowing the devil to motivate and move him. If you get the Greek, it says the accuser. Judas was allowing the devil to work in his life. He spake, it says right here, not of the devil. He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. On the night before his death, Jesus sent out another warning to Judas. And John, the 13th chapter, as I referred to a moment ago, but he said after the sop, Satan entered into him. Or one rendering says, after Judas had taken the piece of bread, Satan entered him. Here they were partaking of the Lord's Supper, which we're going to do tonight, Lord willing. And here the devil's working on Judas right during the act. Jesus warned him, but he didn't receive counsel. Then said Jesus unto him, "That thou doest, do quickly." When Jesus mentioned a betrayer in their midst, the other disciples worried that they were the one Jesus was speaking about, or that they would prove disloyal. In fact, they were a bit mystified and confused. You read there in John, the 13th chapter. Let me just lift a couple of verses there. In John 13 and
Verse 22, John 13, 22. Then the disciples looked one on another, doubting of whom he spake. Who's Jesus talking about? Am I going to betray him? Certainly not. Well, it comes on down there that even when Jesus told Judas, what you're about to do, do quickly, Judas left the Last Supper. The others at the table simply thought Judas had been sent to buy more food or to give something to charity. You read in verse 28, it says, now no man at the table knew for what intent he spake this unto him. For some of them thought, because Judas had the bag, or he was the treasurer, that Jesus had said unto him, buy those things that we have need of against the feast, or that he should give something to the poor. But that's not what Jesus was talking about. Judas Iscariot betrayed the Lord with a kiss, perfectly in keeping with his brazen duplicity, or disloyalty, dishonesty, and deception. After committing his atrocious act, Judas was seized with remorse and returned the 30 silver coins to the chief priests and elders. But we learn that remorse does not equal repentance. Rather than make amends or seek forgiveness, we find a very sad, sober, and serious commentary to Judas's end. It simply says, he went away and hanged himself. Go back to our scripture text. Very stirring ending. 27th chapter of Matthew. 27th chapter, let's get those words. The Bible says in that the bottom of that fifth verse, the balance of it, and departed Judas and went and hanged himself. Judas Iscariot fulfilled the prophecy penned in Psalms 41 and 9. Even my close friend, someone I trusted, one who shared my bread, has turned against me. Judas did that. Yet Judas was fully responsible for his actions. Jesus said, the Son of Man goeth as it is written of him, but woe unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Listen to the words of our Lord. It had been better for that man if he had not been born. Pretty sobering statement. Given the fact of Judas's close proximity to Jesus during his 3.5 years of earthly ministry, it is hard to imagine how he could follow through on such a disastrously demise and betrayal. Following Mary's anointing of Jesus just 6 days before his Passover, as I alluded to in John the 10th chapter, let's pick up a few verses there. See, these words here are not just for historical merit. It's for our benefit today. Any one of us could be guilty of betraying Christ. And it starts by failing to receive counsel, failing to take in God's eternal word. In John the 12th chapter, we reject it rather than take it in. John the 12th chapter, verse number 4, says, then saith one of the disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold? Here Mary is committing a beautiful act on Jesus, anointing him, pouring herself out to Christ. And there's Judas over there going, well, why was all that money wasted? You know, saints, let me just bring it right down to where we live today. It would be easiest for us to sit around and go, well, camp meeting costs us $20,000. Maybe we should stop doing camp meeting. Come on. I'm just bringing it right down to what the principle. There's a principle here. The principle is we can't put a price on spiritual matters. Well, I just don't know if we should have revivals. They just cost the congregation too much. How about our soul? Is there anything worth more than our soul? See, Judas had that attitude that those who are stingy and too frugal, I'm all for trying to save where we can, but there's a danger in being too frugal, where we become a miser and a penny pincher, and when there are needs around us, we withhold, and the Bible says we should do the opposite. Amen. Here it was, Judas, and this is not to make anyone feel bad, but I'm just stirring us up this morning. There's a principle here that Judas was engulfed in. Oh, but how about the money involved here? Well, what does the Bible say? This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief. See, if people paid their tithes and offerings rather than robbing God, the church would have everything it needs. I can take you to Malachi and teach you that we need to tithe and give offerings. Tithing's your 10%. That's not yours to begin with. It's the Lord's. You're stealing from God if you don't give 10% off every paycheck. Every dime you earn, 10% right off the top, to the Lord, to the congregation. Amen. And then above that is your offering as God sets it in your heart, or Paul said, purpose is in his heart to give, not grudgingly. God loves a cheerful giver. You give on top of that. Amen. Now, I wasn't intending to go there this morning, but that just comes to mind. And I do my best to listen to the Lord. But there was Judas going, well, why wasn't it sold and given to the poor? See, Judas was trying to look real good. Come on, we could sell this spikenard or ointment. We could sell it and make all this money. Did Judas really care about the poor? No, he wanted more money in the bag. More money that he could perhaps steal from or take. Not that he cared, but because he was a thief and had to beg and bear what was put therein. Then Jesus said, let her alone. Against the day of my burying hath she kept this. For the poor always ye have with you, but me ye have not always. Judas refused to receive counsel from Christ, which he lived and he died to regret. Receive counsel. Judas lived. Life ended with regret, all because he refused to receive counsel. I must go on. Number two, in addition to receiving counsel to avoid regret, we must regard instruction. What do you mean regard? That word means honor, respect. Or I might say heed, obey. If you want to avoid regret, not only do you need to receive counsel, you need to regard instruction. Amen. None of us have made it. None of us have arrived. We all have a room in our house. The largest room in our house is the room of improvement. And we all have that room in our house, our heart's home, the home in our heart. And every one of us must remain submissive, pliable in the hands of the potter, and be open to correction. Hope open to instruction. Well, I thought I was doing pretty good, and I thought this was the way to go. But you know, after you preached, or after this one testified, or after you talked to me about a concern you had, you know, maybe I need to change what I thought I should be doing. That's being open. I take my performing groups to festivals each year, and I can't go into those festivals with those students going, we've arrived, we've made it, I know all there is to know. After all, this is my 21st year of directing orchestras, and blah, 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 blah. We can't take that approach. There's always room to grow. There's always something I can learn. There's always something I can maybe try and do a little differently. Or maybe it's something I used to do, I need to bring back and try it again. That happens in our lives. We maybe have let some things slip, let some things go. And then it's brought up in our mind. God brings it up through the preached word of God or a testimony or just through our meditations and Bible reading. And we need to make some changes. See, Hebrews, the second chapter, he warns us there. If I could go there just hurriedly, Hebrews, the second chapter, it says, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. See, the natural tendency is even in those things that we often hear preached about, there's still a natural tendency to let them slip. How often do people kneel at an altar of prayer and say, I'm just not reading like I should, just not praying like I should, just not attending the house of worship like I should? Don't you know that's what you're supposed to be doing? Sure, we all do. I'm sure we all know that. But it's easy just to let those things slip. Well, I can always go to church. It's there when I need it. It's not going to be there when you need it all the time. God doesn't work that way. He's not like your phone. You just pick it up and dial his number. Judas didn't find it. We can read where Esau carefully sought repentance with tears, and he couldn't find it. He won't always be there. The day of his grace, one songwriter said, is past. You may get across the line that's drawn, another songwriter says, where you've gone too far, where the call of his spirit is lost. Amen. We must take this seriously. Receive counsel. Number two, regard instruction. Listen to me. It's been said, Only a fool learns from his own mistakes. The wise man learns from the mistakes of others. Parents, our children don't have to go down the roads that we went when we were in sin. They don't have to learn these mistakes on their own. If they'll listen and receive counsel and receive or regard instruction, they don't have to go down that road. Don't take that cop-out attitude of, well, I did it, so I guess they're going to have to do it. No, they don't. For one, they've got greater knowledge now than you had. Because you've instructed them. You've brought them to church. And number two, you should want better for them than what you had. So warn them. Come on. Don't sit around and go, well, that's just something I got involved with, so I guess they will. I tried cigarettes, so they're going to try. No, they don't have to try cigarettes. Warn them. Come on. Be a man. Be a woman. They go out of your house half clad, half naked. Don't let them do it. Don't let them do it. You're the parent. Come on, that stirs me when parents get this attitude of, well, I guess that's just the way it was with me, so I guess they'll have to do it. No, they don't. Let me give you that quote again, and please take this in as food for thought. A fool learns from his own mistakes. The wise man learns from the mistakes of others. To avoid being a fool, we must receive spiritual counsel and highly regard godly instruction. A sad, sobering, and serious commentary is found in the words of Anne Frank. You've heard of Anne Frank? A German-born Jewish girl who kept a diary, a very famous one, became famous. But listen to what Anne Frank said. She said, dead people receive more flowers than the living ones because regret is stronger than gratitude. Let's appreciate the ability to receive counsel. Let's appreciate the ability to receive instruction by being in service, reading God's word. Because it could be a situation where we end up, let's just say the individual ends up in hell. And I'm going to get to that in a moment here. But one of the things that torments that soul in hell is regret. Ceaseless ages of eternity. You don't lose your mind in hell. You very much have your mind. Jesus uncapped eternity. He uncapped hell. And there was the rich man. He was concerned. He had a soul burden for his brothers. He very much had his mind. Oh, yes, he did. And he was in torment. So one of those things I believe that torments a soul in hell is regret. I had this opportunity. I had that opportunity. I had this opportunity. I had that opportunity. But I neglected. I neglected my salvation. Amen. Dead people receive more flowers than the living ones because regret is stronger than gratitude. Jesus, the Bible says, John writing, that Jesus in John the first chapter, let's read just a few verses, a couple verses there, John 1 and 14, and the word, capital W, proper noun, speaking about Christ, was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, and the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Verse 17 says, you spake there of Jesus Christ, by grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. John wrote that Christ was the Word. Do we all understand that? Christ embodied the Word. He was the Word in flesh. When Judas rejected Christ, in reality, he was rejecting the Word of God. Let me just prove that to you. Psalms 119. Do we receive instruction and counsel from God's word? Look, Psalms 119, verse number 197. Psalms 119, 97. Psalms 119, 97. Oh, how I love thy law. It is my meditation all the day. Thou, through thy commandments, speaking about his law, his commandments, thou hast made me wiser than mine enemies, for they are ever with me. I have more understanding than all my teachers, for thy testimonies are my meditation. I understand more than the ancients, because I keep thy precepts. I have refrained my feet from every evil way, that I might keep what? Thy word. What gives us understanding? What gives us guidance, counsel, instruction? It's God's word. I have not departed from thy judgments, for thou hast taught me. How sweet are thy words unto my taste, yea, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Through thy precepts I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way. In the heart of every person, see, wisdom is found by regarding, heeding, obeying God's word. And that's what Judas rejected. He rejected Christ, which was the word, or which is the word of God. In the heart of every person, down below all of other wants and aspirations, there is a profound longing to know the way of spiritual life. The world is crying, "What shall I do to be saved?" Of all books, the Bible is the only one that answers that universal cry. There are other books which set forth morality with more or less correctness, but there are none that suggest a blotting out of the record of misspent past or an escape from penalty of the broken law. There are other books which have poetry, but there are none which sing the songs of salvation or give a troubled soul the peace that floweth like a river. There are other books which have many other things out there, but there's no book like the Word of God. And saints of God, if we're going to avoid regret, we must receive counsel and regard instruction. Instruction from where? From the Word of God. One songwriter said, "His word will stand. His word will stand. Though stars should fall and mountains turn to sand, though no man believes him, still God will be true. His promise is sure, his love will endure, and forever his word will stand." Paul proclaimed, "Let God be true, but every man a liar." Psalms 119:89 says, "Thy word, O Lord, is forever settled in heaven." One rendering says it's firmly fixed. We will not change God's word. So it behooves us to accept it. It behooves us this morning to receive it and to highly regard it. Can I give you a third and final way to avoid regret? Proverbs 8:33, the words of the wise men come to mind here. Hear instruction, there it is, that regarding instruction. Hear instruction and be wise and refuse it not. Not only do we need to receive counsel and regard instruction, we must not refuse it. Refuse it not. Did you know that there's much instruction and godly counsel in the house of worship? And it comes through the preached word of God. Look at Romans, the 10th chapter. See, we must not ever underestimate, minimize the importance of inspired messages by the Holy Ghost. And I'm not just saying that for my, I'm saying that because God's word says it. I'm going to read it to you. Romans, the 10th chapter. Romans 10:14 says this. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? Romans 10:14. And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Oh, I need to, you know, sit under a good teacher. Well, that's part of pastoralship, is teaching the Word of God. I don't minimize that. I teach a lot. Spend a lot of my preaching teaching. But God ordained that we sit under a preacher, a pastor. Jeremiah 3:15, that's where we get our knowledge and instruction, is through a pastor, much of it. And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah said, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Where do we get all this? Through the preached word of God. 1 Corinthians 1:17. For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect. Verse number 18, it says, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish, them that are lost, them that are dying in sin. It's foolishness. What do you mean sit under a preacher? But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. This is where we get our power. One way is through the preached word of God. Verse 21, it says, for after that is in the wisdom of God. The world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching, not foolish preaching, but foolishness of preaching, to save them that believe. To those who perish, it's foolishness. But to those who are saved, it's power. Amen. Well, I don't like it that way. Well, you didn't set it up. God did. So you better learn to like it that way. Amen. Well, I just want singing every service. Well, that's not God's chosen method. Now, God may work through a song. We may have an altar call, and that's up to the Lord. The Holy Ghost leads our services. But that's still not God's chosen method. We wouldn't have a song without the preached word of God. They sang that beautiful song. Brother Ryan actually requested that beautiful song. But we wouldn't even have a good song to sing unless God had delivered us from a life of sin. You're reading Psalms, the 40th division. It said, lifted us up and out of sin, and he put a new song in our heart. He gave us something to sing about. But it all is because of the word of God and the preaching of God's eternal word. Saints of God, the warning tonight or this morning is to refuse not. In Hebrews, the 12th chapter, it says here, Hebrews, the 12th chapter, and verse 25, see that ye refuse not him that speaketh. For if they escape not, who refused him that spake on earth, or Christ, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven. To avoid being a fool, we must receive counsel, regard godly instruction, and refuse it not. Now, what about the regrets often expressed by people in adulthood and marriage? The wise old adage is, there's one thing worse than never getting married, and that's marrying the wrong one. Young people, I want to warn us this morning to make sure that you're marrying the one that God has chosen for you, lest you live to regret that decision. My mind was turned to Isaac and Rebecca. As Abraham sought out a wife for his son Isaac, the Bible says this in Genesis 24:14, and let it come to pass that the damsel to whom I shall say, let down thy pitcher, I pray thee that I may drink, and she shall say, drink, and I will give thee thy camel's drink also. Let the same be she, or several translations say the one, let the same be she, or the one, that thou hast appointed, several renderings say chosen, for thy servant Isaac. And thereby shall I know that thou hast showed kindness unto my master. God has one chosen for you. And just as Abraham was vitally concerned that his son get the right one, Isaac was not a young strapling. The Bible says he was 40 years old. But Abraham was vitally concerned that Isaac get the right companion. Amen. I say this morning, God's even more concerned about you. God, I know Abraham's the type of God the Father, but God is vitally concerned. Young people, lest you live a life filled with regretting that decision, I implore you in Christ's stead to seek his way and his will for your walk. Concerning where you're going to live, where you're going to work, which congregation you're going to attend, you better make sure that God is in all these decisions, lest your future be filled with regret. Our text says, then Judas, which had betrayed him when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself. He regretted. Can you imagine the guilt Judas must have felt after he betrayed Christ and realized his actions were irreversible? There are actions we make that are irreversible. And saints of God, listen, I'm not trying to make anyone feel bad. You should actually thank me for this message. And not because of me, thank God for the message. Because it's warning each of us, myself included, that we don't have to be live with regret. We don't have to be filled with regret. If we will do as God's word instructs us and receive counsel, regard instruction, and refuse it not, we can avoid future regrets. Amen. Look at Judas's end. Judas's end. I appreciate you listening so intently. Matthew, the 27th chapter. Let's read that verse again, verse number 5. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. According to Matthew, Judas hanged himself. You pick up Acts, the 1st chapter, and Luke, styled as the beloved physician, and I might just interject this little food for thought. Did you know that the Apostle Paul had his own private physician? His companion in travels, Luke, the beloved physician. He actually styles him in Colossians 4 and 14 as Luke, the beloved physician. Paul had his own first personal physician. He was a man of God by the name of Luke, the same writer that our gospel Luke is written by, Luke the physician. Are you all with me? Isn't that kind of cool? The Apostle Paul, God used Luke. We have a physician in our congregation right over here. It's kind of nice to have those around, aren't they? Or isn't it, rather? Amen. We might have a little boo-boo and a little scrape. We want a little attention, don't we? And it's nice to have those physicians in the house. Well, Paul had Luke. But the reason, one of the reasons I bring this up is Luke, being a physician, gets a little more graphic. And I want you to listen to Judas's end. Luke now writing the book of Acts. And it says Luke in Acts 1 and 18. Let's read a couple of verses here. Now this man purchased a field with the reward of iniquity and falling headlong. Listen to how the physician writes of this account. Are you all with me? I often tell my students, can you hear me? Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Yes, we can hear you. Okay, now I'll talk, kind of thing. All right. Falling headlong, he burst asunder in the midst, and all his bowels gushed out. Matthew just said he hanged himself. But let's hear from a physician. His bowels gushed out. You say that's too graphic. I'm just bringing you what the Word of God says. Amen. Here he was, fell headlong, and his bowels burst out or gushed out. Some theologians believe that the limb from which he was hanging broke and the resulting fall split open his body. Now, whether that's true or not, what we do know is Judas's demise was horrific. The additional detail we learn from Luke is that after Judas hanged himself, his body fell into the very field purchased with his ill-gotten gains. What horrifying, horrific ending for a man, for any man, let alone a man who had been a disciple of Jesus Christ. Hebrews 13 and 12. Now before you say, oh, that'll never happen to me, listen to the words of the Hebrew writer, Hebrews 3 and 12 and 13. Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief and departed from the living God, but exhort one another daily while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. When Leonardo da Vinci sought to paint that famous painting, The Last Supper, he sought for that individual that best represented Christ. And he got him. And I'm going to just abbreviate the story for sake of time, but basically, he found, and I think he was maybe a choir member in a church, but anyways, he found that individual. Looks like what he thought would be Christ. So he painted him. Time went on, months, maybe a few years, and he sought for that man to paint, that man that best represented Judas. And he found him in a prison house. And as he was painting what he thought looked like Judas, that man began to cry, and tears welled up in his eyes. And that painter, Leonardo da Vinci, said, what in the world's going on? He says, and I'm abbreviating, paraphrasing in my own words, he said, don't you recognize me? Well, I don't recognize you. Who are you? You look like a Judas to me. I was the man that you chose for Jesus. And I was Jesus. You painted me as Jesus. But because of sin, because of my choices, it's taken a havoc on my life. And now I look like a Judas. And that poor man lived with regret because of choices and decisions he had made. Amen. How about in our lives this morning? Every one of our lives has great potential, great possibilities in the future. Our future is so dependent upon the choices we're making today. Our future's built on the choices we're making right now. Choices we as parents make will impact the future of our children. Every mother and father should be here this morning. Oh, I know we have obligations from time to time, but choices we're making right now Parents, we can avoid a life of regrets with rearing our children, running the affairs of our family, if we'll receive godly counsel and regard the instruction and refuse it not. Train up our children in the way they should go, the Bible says. The way that God designed they should go is our responsibility. While you may live to regret all that money and the time you spent in personal hobbies and pursuits and activities and ambitions, you'll never regret the time you spent in church. See, someday that ball bat will be laid down, and it'll probably be good if it were laid down sooner than later, but that'll be laid down so we can get to church. You'll never regret the time you spent in church, though. Oh, I know, you get unhappy with me. It's all right. They wanted to crucify Christ, and they did. And as I said last Sunday, if a man of God preaches the Bible like you should, he won't be a popular preacher. Amen. We need to lay down those things and get to church. We're not going to regret the time spent in church. But we're going to regret someday that time we wasted out on the ball field. And I'm all for athletics, don't get me wrong. I think they can teach you a lot of wonderful skills, teamwork, activity, get you active. And there's so much sitting around in our society. I'm all for it. But not during church, I'm not. Not during church, I'm not. Not during church. We need to lay all those things aside and get to church. And don't refuse it. Because you're not refusing me, you're refusing Christ, who's not speaking from earth, he's speaking now from heaven. In one sense, he is speaking from earth through the man of God, but he's speaking to us from heaven. See that ye refuse it not. It's been wisely noted that the influence of one's parents is powerful and permanent. Parents, we should desire better for our children. Someone said the moments we waste, weighed down by regret, will never be returned to us. The moments we waste, weighed down by regret, will never be returned to us. A prayer of Moses, the man of God, said this. He prayed, "So teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom." In other words, teach us to number our days so that our lives won't be filled with empty pursuits and passions of this life, but that will put our stuff into the kingdom of God, will put our life into the kingdom of God. Now, I'm going to bring this to a close. You've been such a good audience and such a good attention. But Matthew 27:3, in closing our text, then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself, or he regretted his decision. We find there in that fourth verse where he sought for mercy, grace, and opportunity. He was seeking someone to help him take this money, but they wouldn't take it, or they didn't want it. Amen. Certainly not the way he wanted it to be used, or what he desired. To receive counsel and regard instruction, we must be humble individuals, and we must not refuse it. Proverbs 22:17 says, "Bow down thine ear and hear the words of the wise." Or one rendering says, "Listen, consent, and submit to the words of the wise." When Jesus uncapped eternity, and I referenced it a moment ago, when he uncapped eternity and gave us a look inside, we don't read where Lazarus had any regrets. He was at rest. However, the rich man in Luke 16:23 was tormented by his past life. God desires to help every one of us this morning avoid the foolish, fateful, and ultimately fatal path that Judas took and live eternally tormented by if-onlys, what might have been, and a host of other regrets. If you desire to avoid facing regret in the future, it would be wise to bow down at an altar of prayer this morning and ask God to give you wisdom with your choices, wisdom with your words, wisdom with your ways, wisdom with the roads you're choosing to take and those plans you're endeavoring to make, lest you face an unhappy future filled with regrets. If you'll receive counsel, regard instruction, and refuse it not, and be saved this morning, the only regret that you will have is, "I wish I would have done it sooner. I wish I would have done it sooner." And you often hear people say that. I wish I would have got saved sooner. Judas greedily desired money and popularity, which led to his dreadful demise. I wonder this morning, what are you after? What are you seeking in life? Judas, it was money, it was popularity. But I say this morning, I'll just submit to you that that's still what people are seeking this morning, is wealth and popularity. And if that's your sole purpose in life, you're going to miss the mark. And you're going to find yourself someday filled with a life of regrets. Amen. These warnings come to us from, and they're from God's eternal word. This is not my idea. It's God's eternal word. And they come to us to try to get us to steer our lives in a little different direction. But to do that, we have to submit. If I came up to a roadblock and that worker for the state says, "Now, sir, the road's closed ahead. We've had to close it and shut it down because it's going to mean death. You need to go in this direction." I should submit for the welfare of my eternal soul, right? And my body, too. I should submit to that. It's no different with God's eternal word. If God's telling us this morning, I need to change directions here. I need to do differently. I need to spend more time doing this instead of all this time doing that. We need to submit to that, bow down our ear to that instruction, humble ourselves and go, "You know what, Lord? You're right." And when we do that, it's not only going to make us a stronger individual and a better man, a better woman, but it's going to help us to avoid regrets in the future. Amen. Regret. Regret. God doesn't want us to be filled with regret. He doesn't want us to live a life of just regret. Amen. If you have a need this morning, God wants to help you. But you got to be willing to receive that instruction. Take it in and refuse it not. Shall we stand? Shall we sing? If you have a need, won't you come? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness. We ask you, Father, just to speak to hearts as you've already done. Help us, Father, to obey you and submit to your eternal word. Go with us now in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have a need, won't you come? Let's sing a song.
Page 129 in the Church of God hymnal.
You may be here and you lived a life in sin and you have a lot of regrets, and I realize that. We all have regrets in our past life.
But I want to tell you this morning that there's healing for that. I don't preach to hurt people. I preach to help people. And I want to help you with these words. Paul said in Philippians, the third chapter, forgetting those things which are behind, we can get the power from God that'll help us. It's only the devil that wants to bring up the past, bring up the past, bring up the past. God wants us to move on. And then to avoid future regrets. That's where he comes in. That's where his power comes in. But I want to let you know this morning that we don't want to hurt anyone here. We all have regrets, but God wants to help us. And we can get that power to move on, press towards the mark, and forget the past. And then he wants to help us do differently in the future. And so that's really the premise of the message, I believe. The burden on my heart is to see that we move on from our past and do differently in the future. If you have a need this morning, won't you come as we sing at least one more verse? Amen. Go ahead, Sister Lily. Appreciate every one of you. Love you dearly. We're happy to speak with you if you want to talk about any of these things. Remember our service tonight at 6 o'clock. And listen, we're going to meet up here to start the service.